let's talk about requirement number 6, develop securely. This simplified name represents the need to have your developers train to implement security features in what they develop, as well as touching on the timely installation of patches, both for your applications and also the ones that you obtain off the shelf. Let's take a look. Requirement number 6, with a full name of develop and maintain secure systems and applications, is about securing both your own developed applications and software that's off the shelf, with a focus being mostly on your own software. It's important to note that this is one of the most elusive requirements, for one simple reason, that is, in your own software development lifecycle, developers usually care about functionality and not security. Look, they usually want to create interfaces, structure highly efficient database queries, create lightning-fast caching mechanisms, but they're usually not very excited to check for security features, encrypting communications, avoiding cross-site scripting, buffer overruns, and so on. In fact, many development teams don't even know about these, or they do, but they don't care. This requirement forces you, as we'll see, to put security features into practice. We have 7 sub-requirements this time. First, it's about doing regular vulnerability assessing and risk ranking, both for your applications and off-the-shelf ones. And the reason is sub-requirement 6.2, which is about timely patch installation. Once you rank the vulnerabilities, you want to install patches for the critical ones as soon as possible. And as we'll see, there's a different timing for critical patches and all other ones. Then, 6.3 is about having a secure software development lifecycle. In short, you have to include security requirements in the software development process and make sure that developers actually implement them. Then, 6.4 is about development change controls. In other words, analyzing the consequences of a new version of developed software and rerunning security tests if there are significant changes, as well as allowing for rollbacks in case something goes wrong. 6.5 is about secure development training. The only way to make sure that common exploits are avoided is if your development team is trained on how to protect against them. Then 6.6 is about preventing public vulnerabilities. It only applies if you have public-facing applications. You simply need to keep track of the vulnerabilities in those public-facing applications more frequently, because since they're public, they're more easily targeted. And 6.7 is our usual document and enforce all policies and procedures requirement. So all of this must be put on paper and put to use. The first sub-requirement is 6.1, vulnerability and risk ranking. What this means is that every time a third-party vendor publishes a vulnerability, you want to rank it for your specific environment. And notice, vulnerability information doesn't just come from the manufacturers themselves. It may come from information security communities. Maybe someone cracked the protocol or an application. It may come from publications or others. The goal is that this identification and risk ranking is what would result in classifying a patch as critical or not, depending on the risk of that vulnerability, because critical patches must be installed within 30 days. And that's a good segue to 6.2, which is about timely patch installation. It's the follow-up to the previous sub-requirement. You want to install patches soon. And here's the key. There is a specific timeline for patches. Critical patches must be as soon as possible, so within 30 days, period. Other lower-risk patches must be within 2 to 3 months. You need to assume that after this time period, when a vulnerability is published, the whole world knows about it, and attackers are actively scanning for applications and systems that they can exploit. So installing timely patches is not an option. If you fail to install even one critical patch within 30 days, you will fail PCI-DSS compliance. And notice that these patches apply to all software in the CDE. So I'm talking about payment applications, cardholder data transfer applications, cardholder storage servers, and everything else. Sub-requirement 6.3 is about having a secure software development lifecycle. It's the elusive part of this requirement. It's getting your developers to care about security. So your own development lifecycle must include security requirements. In short, let's say that you are a bank rolling out a new payment application. Where are the security requirements? For example, all traffic protected by TLS or SSL, avoiding cross-site scripting, and more. Are there even security requirements? You would be shocked at the number of organizations that develop payment applications and big name ones and literally have no security requirements in their requirement list. Zero. And by the way, this is regardless of methodology, whether it's waterfall or agile or any other. And it's regardless of the application as well. Whether it's an application to send money to friends, to pay for products, or to manage your personal credit cards, it doesn't matter. You need the same security requirements. Many organizations think that some applications that are more formal, such as a payment application, need more security than an informal one, for example, to transfer money to friends. But in terms of IT, they both store or transmit cardholder data, and they're both vulnerable to attack, period. And also be aware that this can fail at all stages of the process. So it may be the case that I mentioned where you don't even have security requirements, or they can be raised but not actually developed. They're pushed down the priority list, or they can be developed but not tested, or they can fail at any other point. Consider the following. If the security requirements don't end up working in the production version, you failed. That's it. It's that simple. So training developers on secure code, which will come later, is a key part of this. They must be aware of all possible attacks and prevent that while coding. And finally, code reviews of developed code before deployment by peers are required. Sub-requirement 6.4 is about change controls in developed applications. It has the goal of preventing security vulnerabilities in case you make a change, for example, that breaks a security feature. So first, the environments must be separated if they're not already. This shouldn't even be PCI-DSS required. It's just good development practices. Development and testing must be separate environments from production, period, and possibly even separate themselves. Then, development or testing credentials and accounts must be removed in production. And I'm talking about fake users, fake data, or everything else. And this is a good practice because sometimes developers use real data from the database for development, but then they don't take those data out in production, and you end up with an application that has a small batch of real credit card numbers. As you're guessing, that's not very secure. Then, it's important to retest the application for PCI-DSS compliance after significant changes. And I mean both significant security changes or just significant feature changes. So, for example, if you have a banking application and you did risk assessment and vulnerability assessment and you roll out a new set of features around peer-to-peer payment that it didn't have before, that app needs to be retested. Now, again, the definition of significant changes is subjective, but use common sense. If you completely change your application and you don't retest it, you will fail compliance. Then, 6.5 is about secure development training. In short, the only way to address common vulnerabilities in development to minimize exploits is to train developers to protect against them. And notice that I don't mean any of these, I mean all of these. There is a full list on the PCI-DSS reference manual, but examples include, first, code injection, SQL injection, operating system command injection, such as in Linux, also buffer overflows. Then, insecure encryption or key management. I'm both talking about weak encryption protocols or weak key management. For example, including the encryption keys in the source code of the program. Another, insecure communications, protocols, or ports that allow an attacker to exploit these vulnerabilities. Also, improper error handling. For example, telling an end user more than what they should know in the logging entries, including local addresses, database credentials, and others. Remember, it's not just the developers who read the logs, or cross-site scripting, or access control vulnerabilities. All of these must be accounted for in the development of all applications within the char data environment. Then, 6.6 is only applicable if you have public-facing applications, and this is about preventing public vulnerabilities. In other words, because your apps face the public, they are a lot more exposed to attack, so they must be reviewed especially frequently. The reviews can either be done through manual periodic reviewing by specialists or with an automated tool. Again, common sense. As long as they're tested, that's fine. The imposed periods by the PCI-DSS are at least once per year, but also on every significant change. So same example as previously. If you have a banking application facing the public, even if a year has not passed, if you develop a set of new features and they're very significant, you have to test for public vulnerabilities again, because it's a significant change. The logic here is that new vulnerabilities are going to show up at least once a year, and they're definitely going to show up if you roll out new features. Then 6.7 is our old friend. Document and enforce these policies and procedures, and make sure that the employees, in this case, in specific, the developers, are aware of the policies and procedures. They have to develop securely, other employees need to identify vulnerabilities, install patches, and so on. Whoever is the owner of these tasks must make them happen. What are some examples? The first are common vulnerabilities. These can almost be considered a checklist in terms of development and testing. They're very known and they've been here for a long time. Check for injections, check for buffer overflows, check for cross-site scripting, and all others. You can literally create a checklist for your developers. They're all known and they're all easy to protect against. They just have to do it. Then, remember that patching timeline varies. While the timeline for installation of critical patches is not negotiable, for other patches, it is. It does need to make sense, however, as in many other requirements. So if other patches are installed within 2 months, because that's synchronized with the regular vulnerability testing practice, that makes sense. But if they're installed after 2 months just because, then you fail this requirement. Then, remember that failure to address security requirements can occur at any point of the software development lifecycle. For example, password requirements. Maybe they're never raised in the first place. Maybe they're raised, but they're not developed. Maybe they're developed, but they're not tested. Or any other variation. Remember, if they're not rolled out to production, fully functional, you fail this requirement. What are the key takeaways for this requirement? The first is that it's about developing securely, securing both third-party applications, but also your developed ones. In the case of your own developed ones, you want to develop them securely. And in the case of both types, you want to isolate them from vulnerabilities and patch those vulnerabilities. Then, 6.1 is about risk ranking, analyzing vulnerabilities from third parties and ranking the criticality of the vulnerabilities. And then 6.2 is just installing the appropriate patches for those vulnerabilities, critical ones within a month, all other ones between 2 to 3 months. Then 6.3 and 6.4. 6.3 is about including security requirements in your development lifecycle, while 6.4 is about controls on versions that were already pushed. They must be tested for security vulnerabilities and include rollback options. So this is before the development, and this is after the development. 6.5 is about training developers to care about security vulnerabilities, injections, buffer overflows, and all others. 6.6 is a specific sub-requirement for public-facing applications. If your application is public-facing, it must be tested more frequently, period. Once per year,
or on any significant change. And finally, 6.7 is our document and enforce sub-requirement. All of these that we talked about should not be done informally. Everything should be on paper and put to use by employees. Risk assessment, vulnerability assessment, developer training, patching timelines, testing and rollback for pushed versions, all of these on paper and put to use.
So as we see, requirement number 6 does start with a focus on your own developers, training them to develop securely, and actually including that in the requirements for development, but also doing risk assessment, vulnerability assessment, and installing patches in a timely manner, both critical and non-critical.